Those of you who have been with us in our series of James have gotten used to the harshness of the exhortations that this church leader has given to his former congregation, now scattered throughout all of Asia. The last few messages that I've given have kept to the same tone of the author. And amazing what I find is that many of you said, I'm grateful for being beaten up by the Word of God. Watch your tongue, avoid favoritism, check your personal ambition, don't give in to temptations. Well, I've got good news for you masochistic types. James continues on. If you have your Bible right now, I want you to turn to chapter 5, verse 1. And this is how he begins. Now listen, you rich people, weep and wail because of the misery that is coming upon you. With that, let's open with a word of prayer. And let's ask God what he wants to do. Father, thank you for this time. I pray for our people right now that, Lord, you would touch their hearts and let them know that whatever you are asking of us is for our own good. And thank you for this message that greed is not good. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, we note that James begins his commandment with that Jewish idiom, now listen. It's as if he's wagging his finger directly at you and saying, pay attention to what I have to say. He's addressing here the rich folk. But what rich folk? One commentator I read advocates that James was speaking to non-Christians, but that wouldn't make sense because throughout the letter before, he's referred to the readers as my brothers, and even after this passage, my brothers. So, sorry, this letter is written to Christians, and this specific exhortation is written to Christians who are wealthy. Now, some of you are saying, well, that's great. Let's go after the rich people, those greedy misers who rob the poor and add to their already overbloated bank accounts. Go after those CEOs who've raided their workers' retirement plans. Go after the doctors who take poor patients to court for non-payment. Go after the greedy landlords who won't fix up their slums for the tenants. The world belongs to the rich, right? And it's about time they got theirs. James tells these rich folk to weep and wail. That first term just speaks of an audible whimper. The picture of someone lying in misery, sobbing uncontrollably. The second term speaks of their spirit. They are absolutely miserable without peace. No joy, no hope. Why? Because the real judge, not the superior court, not the courts around the land, but the real judge, God, is going to pronounce them guilty as charged. Sounds terrible. And I feel for them. And then we begin to think about it. Hey, wait a minute. Who are the rich? Well, by the world standard, even the poorest in America are probably in the top 10% of the wealthiest in the world. If you've traveled to a third world countries like I have, you'll see people living in abject poverty. No clean water, no sewage systems, no electricity, no medical care, no jobs, and certainly no retirement. That's what I saw in Guatemala, and in Rwanda, and Cambodia, and Nepal. And those of you, maybe if you've ever gone or heard about those in North Korea. In Guatemala, for example, the kids we visited got only one annual checkup a year, and that was because a Christian organization was there to help. How many times have your children been to the doctor this last year? In Guatemala, again, most of the kids will never make it past second grade. And the lucky ones get up to fifth grade. Even those in America living in the worst ghettos do better than them. And what does that say for us who have college educations or masters or even doctorates, professional jobs, living in 3,000 square foot homes and having high-end vehicles? We go without food for about 5 hours, and I hear my kids saying that and saying they're starving to death. Friends, none of us will know true starvation like many in Africa. So by the world standards, you and I have to admit we're rich. So what does James have against the rich? Well, the Bible is replete with examples of rich people who actually are commended. In the Old Testament, Boaz, the wealthy landowner in the book of Ruth, is painted as a righteous man. And in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul commends his wealthy friend Philemon for having a church meet in his home. Even Barnabas, one of the church leaders, was lifted up by the early church. He sold some property And Acts 4 says that he gave the money to the needy at the Jerusalem church. So why would there be judgment placed on some rich people, as James put it, and blessing on others? Well, we find four specific reasons in the next few verses. And what we're going to find out is that God doesn't have a problem with wealth per se, but rather how you and I handle our wealth. Now let's look at the first reason for judgment upon us all. It's found in verses 2 to 3. He says in verse 2, "Your wealth has rotted and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. Their corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth in the last days." The first reason is found there at the end of verse 3. We as the wealthy of the world will be judged because we have hoarded our wealth. In the animal kingdom, you and I admire squirrels because they store up nuts for the upcoming winter. And likewise, though we don't want them in our house or at our picnic, we also feel the same way about ants because they too gather during the spring and summer to sustain themselves through the harsh winters. And we do the same, don't we? We put money aside for savings or retirement for our children's education. And that's smart. That's wise. But I don't think God has a problem with putting aside emergency funds. He does have a problem, however, with hoarding. He hates the fact that you and I have stockpiled resources, resources that could be used for good, but instead are set aside to satisfy our own cravings. And what kind of cravings? Well, James gives us three. First of all, physical cravings. He begins in verse 2 by saying that our wealth has rotted. He's speaking of the wealthy farmer at the day who had an abundance of fruit and vegetables. Instead of giving his overabundance away, he sits on it and it eventually rots. Think, friends, with me. Go to your cupboard, your pantry, your refrigerator, your freezer right now. How much food do we throw out every week? Or think of the nice restaurants that you and I attended before the pandemic. Did you bring the leftovers home in a doggy bag? You and I have seen films of the slums of Mexico City and Mumbai, India, to know that our refuse, our garbage, sometimes is another man's dinner. And when you go to the grocery store, do you admire all the beautiful fruit and vegetables that are available to us? Rosy red apples, plump peaches, golden bananas. Do you know that as an agricultural policy, our government requires farmers to dump fruit and vegetables that don't meet federal requirements? That holds up prices for produce. Food is literally destroyed rather than given away. If you go to the Midwest, you can come to the end of some dirt roads and find mountains of apples that don't make it to the marketplace because they're an eighth inch smaller than the government regulation. And so, friends, as a wealthy country, many times we as wealthy individuals are wasteful. Physical cravings, there's also worldly cravings. James' second example of hoarding is found in the statement that moths are eating clothes. And you and I have all heard of the alcoholics, those who can't control alcoholic consumption. There are rageaholics that can't control their anger. And there are those who are addicted to gambling. Hopefully, most of you do not fall into any of those categories. But there is a compulsion that some of us are controlled by in our society. And it's actually applauded. What is it? Consumerism. Those who give into the worldly cravings for more snuff. Not just clothes or shoes, but any and all material comforts that you and I believe we absolutely must have. On the way to Southern California, we stopped by the malls in Banning, maybe you've been there, and I'm blown away before the pandemic. You'll see lined up at the Coach store, and again, you know, a lot of Asians from Asia, they're lined up trying to buy $250 purses. Now, as a guy, I've never bought a purse, and I can't imagine spending $100 for a plastic wallet. It just doesn't make my sense. And yet, people are doing that. All the clothes that you and I buy will eventually become not used and eventually either sell on eBay or give it away to Goodwill. That old video game system, the computer hardware that's obsolete, furniture, clothing, shoes, we pay top dollar for something right now, and in a year, 2 years, 10 years, we give it away because of our worldly cravings. And by the way, I'm not immune. A few months ago, I was at my wife's business, and an old guy drives up in a convertible Corvette. And I said, "Man, dude, that's a nice car." He goes, "You can have it for $20,000. I looked at my wife and said, and she said, "So we are all not immune. We all want those nice things, including your pastor right now." Okay, there's a third craving, power craving. Look at verse 3. "Your gold and silver have corroded." Now, those of you who know the attributes of gold and silver know that these two precious metals don't rust. In fact, that's the beauty of them. They don't rust. And what James is speaking of with regard to power cravings is the notion that you and I accumulate money, stocks, bonds, real estate to satisfy our cravings for power. Because money is power. I'm remembering Aladdin. My kids love watching that movie. And Jafar says, "You know the golden rule? The one with the most gold rules." Well, that's true. Wealth is control. The question is this, friends: do you control your money, or does your money control you? Too much wealth blinds us to reality. It colors our vision. A.W. Tozer, the great preacher at the beginning of the 20th century, said that two small dimes strategically placed on our eyes can obscure our vision. It shuts us out to seeing the mountains that God has created. It prevents us from seeing the needy on the street. He ends up by saying that it doesn't take large quantities of money to come between us and God. Just a little placed in the wrong position will effectively obscure our view. I look to myself first. I ask myself, how much is enough? How much wealth do I need to feel secure? One time I did a Sunday school class on wealth, and I asked these men in the class, "How much money do you need to feel secure?" Some said $10,000, $100,000 in the bank. One guy said $10 million, and I'm thinking to myself, "You need $10 million to feel secure?" Well, that very idea indicts us. The wealth that we consider security, James says, will testify before God and eat away at our flesh. So hoarding is wrong. God does not want us to do it. In the Old Testament, remember the manna that came down? God said, "Just get enough for the day. And on Saturday, get double the amount," right before Sabbath. But what did they do? They decided to get more, and it rotted away. Jesus said what? "Give us this day our daily bread." We need to focus on just what we need, not all the things we want to accumulate. Hoarding is wrong because it gives into our physical, our worldly, our power craving. But James says there's a second problem as well, and it's this: we as the wealthy of the world will be judged because we have failed to compensate others fairly. Look at verse 4. "Look, the wages you failed to pay the workmen who mowed your fields are crying out against you. The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord Almighty." You see, in first century Palestine, just like today, there was a concentration of wealth, such that the landowners were limited and few. These men would lease out their land to the poor workers so that they would farm it, but get very little of the produce. And it was the custom of the at that time that workers were paid daily, not weekly or monthly. Why? The reason is that the wealthy landowners had savings to live off of, but the poor farmers had enough only to live for that day, so they needed that wage. And it's obvious to see that in this situation that the wealthy landowners held all the power, and some took advantage of the situation and withheld wages. Where would a worker go then? Well, there was nowhere else, and so they were at the mercy of the landowners. Praise the Lord that our God is just. He not only created the cattle, but the hills upon which they feed. And James says that the harvested land itself cries out against these unjust men. He calls God the Lord Almighty, the Lord of hosts, which is a military term, which speaks of God as a powerful general in charge of all the angelic hosts. He himself will bring a soldier to bear on all of us who are stingy towards others. If you come to my house, I built a beehive fireplace, retention walls, a pond in my backyard. I had the skill to do it, and that was BC, before children. Now I'm too busy to do that kind of stuff. But I didn't have the skill to do the smooth stucco of all those items. So I called upon a guy who manned a crew in our new neighborhood. His name was Sly Ochoa, and I asked him if he could do the work. He gave me an estimate, and he did a great job. And I spent time with Sly, and he shared with me a story of how he had worked on another homeowner's house doing the same thing. And Sly needed four guys to do it. But when it came time to pay, the guy, he didn't have the money, he said, and for Sly to come the next day. Well, Sly came, the man didn't show up at the door. He came 7 days in a row, the man would not open the door. And finally, Sly realized he's never going to do it. So he gave up. And the guy essentially got free work, and Sly had to pay those four men for their work, even though he didn't get paid. Now, some of you would say, I would never do such a thing. I wouldn't withhold payment on those who do something for me. But maybe we do things that are less obvious, friends. I see it all the time in how we tip. Do you and I tip appropriately? I had a member who worked at a Japanese restaurant in Awatuki, and she said she was embarrassed for members of our church who would come and eat there, and the co-workers noticed that they wouldn't tip and gave her a bad time. Friends, you understand that most waiters and waitresses aren't paid well. They live off of their tips to make a real living. And so would it kill us to give at least 80%, maybe even more, up to 25%? And here's the thing, friends. If you're not going to tip well, if you're going to say grace at a meal and not tip well, then don't say that you're a Christian, okay? Tell them you're Mormon or something. No, I'm kidding. By the way, tip anyone who serves in your home. Not the owner, but someone who comes in to do your plumbing or work on your refrigerator or your hotel. Leave a tip in the room. In fact, when we have free breakfasts, that's what Kwans do. We have three kids, so it's great when the hotel provides the breakfast. I give the person serving the breakfast a tip as well. And don't be overly cautious. You don't have to give 15%, but you want to show people that you care for what they're doing. And if you and I are planning for our retirement and funding our children's education, you and I should be above and beyond. And it's sad that we have the opposite mentality when it comes to taking care of others. If you and I are going to err, let's err on being more generous. Friends, we have that mentality to others. We are being stingy, and God will judge us for it. Third, we as the wealthy of the world will be judged because we live wastefully. We have lived on earth in luxury and self-indulgence. You have fattened yourselves in the day of slaughter, verse 5 says. In the Greek, those terms, luxury and self-indulgence, are fairly synonymous. They both speak of a soft, cushy lifestyle that is wasteful. Friends, you and I don't have to point our fingers at movie stars and those who live in Beverly Hills and multi-million dollar homes and shop on Rodeo Drive, who live extravagant lifestyles. We could easily be taking that for ourselves because you and I live wastefully. We should feel bad that we drive cars that get less than 18 miles per gallon. And we're the only ones in the cars who are driving those. We spoil ourselves with the food we eat. Only certain restaurants will do. We'll spend at one meal enough to feed a family in a third world country for a month. We complain that our TV screens aren't large enough. I remember a long time ago, back in the 90s, I had a 25-inch tube TV. You know what I'm talking about? That was large at the time. But the collegians who came over to my house were laughing at it. And then they were really laughing because I wouldn't have cable. Now you can't get anything in the country for under 42 inches, right? Flat screen. And those are used as monitors. James says that we're like those turkeys at Thanksgiving time. You know, they're not raised on farms. They're raised in turkey factories. They don't roam around. They're simply given feed to fatten them up. They're so fat that domesticated turkeys can't fly. Their chests weigh them down. And we say that's okay because their only purpose is to be front and center at our Thanksgiving feast. Friends, when you and I live wastefully, extravagant lives, we're just like those turkeys. Life seems so good on the farm, just eating and eating. But all we're doing is fattening ourselves up for the slaughter. Instead, my role should be like the man Hudson Taylor, the great missionary to China. You know, his attitude was not just giving God a tithe, 10% of everything. He said to himself, how much do I need, really? And he actually did what we call the reverse tithe. He kept 10% for himself and gave 90% to God. And we argue about the tithe, whether it's pre-tax or post-tax dollars. Friends, if you and I just gave 10%, our church would never be hurting. The average is 2.5% in the country. So obviously someone's not giving. Number four, we as the wealthy of the world would be judged because we have failed to stand up for the disenfranchised. Look at verse 6. You have condemned and murdered innocent men. You were not, who were not opposing you. This is perhaps an extreme indictment that James gives against the wealthy. At their hands, the innocent are murdered. I think what he had in mind was happening to men like the Lord Jesus Christ, who as a righteous man went to the cross. He put up no fight, but went willingly. We can think of men like Stephen, the first Christian martyr, who denounced the hard-heartedness of the Jews in murdering Christ, and he in turn was stoned to death. And again, he didn't put up a fight. He died asking the Lord to forgive them all. James was perhaps foreshadowing his own death, for he was later beheaded for his faith. And it would be hard to say that any of us would dare to murder or advocate the murder of innocent and righteous people, those who are helpless because they don't have the means to defend themselves. But I think in a way we murder innocent people when we don't stand up for justice. And by that I mean true justice. Yeah, we want the child abusers and rapists to pay for their crimes. That's justice. But I'm speaking of the poor, the mentally impaired, the disabled. They have no means to take care of themselves. Those who are discriminated against. And I'm not advocating a welfare state, but friends, if you and I refuse to shell out money or don't want to shell out money to pay for taxes to help these disenfranchised, then we, in a sense, are murdering them. And some of you say, well, government's so wasteful for money. Well, tell me, Christian, what's the alternative? Shouldn't we as a church be the ones who take care of them? That's true. And that's what James is saying. He's denouncing that right here. We as Christians, as a church, should be doing more. Instead, we should have the mindset of Christ when he gave this exhortation in Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 40. He says this, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. And all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you are blessed by my Father. Take your inheritance. The kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. And then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you or thirsty and give you something to drink? When were you a stranger and we invited you in or needing clothes and clothed you? When were you sick or in prison and when did we visit you? And the king will reply, tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did it for me. Friends, God has blessed you and I with wealth, and that can be used to help others or can be used to indulge ourselves. We will each stand before the Lord and have to give an account of what we did or what he's given us. On your outline, write down areas or individuals you can help out. And I pray that all of us will be able to stand before God as good stewards with what he's given us. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time. And I pray that as we, as individuals and as family, as a church, think about what you've given us, that we in turn would give to others. And we thank you for helping us to see this message. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great day in the Lord. We'll see you next week.